Dear students, good morning. Let us start the discussion on today's newspaper, that is 2nd February 2018. So today the entire newspaper is based on budget. Only one extra article which I saw was related to simultaneous elections. So first, for a better understanding, we need to have a framework for the budget. So any budget, it consists of an analysis of previous year, financial year 2017-18, performance in this case, and also projections for the future, that is 2018-19. So in this, we have to divide that into, so fiscal deficit, revenue deficit, these are the things which we will be first looking at. And the next is, in the fiscal deficit or fiscal policy, you have the revenue side, expenditure side. So on the revenue side, our receipt side, we have revenue receipts, capital receipts. On expenditure side, how much is the capital expenditure? How much is the revenue expenditure? So in the revenue receipts, we have tax revenues and non-tax revenues. With regard to capital receipts, most of the discussion is revolving around disinvestments. So with regard to the tax revenues, what are the benefits given to different groups? We talk about farmers and then corporates, income salaried group individuals, old age people, and then we talk about middle class in general, or salaried group, and mostly they coincide with the middle class. So what are the different types of tax benefits? And any new taxes are there proposed in this? That's what we have to see. And then, with regard to capital receipts, what are the targets of disinvestments? Are we close to this target of disinvestment? And then, what is the disinvestment and investment climate in India? Coming to expenditure, revenue expenditure, what are the new welfare schemes that have come into existence? And what is the impact they are going to bring in with regard to our life? And capital expenditure, any new big scale projects are announced by the government or not? So these are the things we need to observe when we read the budget. So when we see the fiscal deficit, revenue deficit, we see the pros or else the future the budget is looking for India, or we get the holistic picture. So let's understand it this way. The fiscal deficit, it is being guided by an act that is called FRBM Act, the Fiscal Responsibility Budget Management Act. According to this, we have to maintain the fiscal deficit close to 3%. And fiscal policy can be also used as growth instrument. When we use it as growth instrument, obviously a stimulus package is necessary, and we have to decrease the taxes, and it leads to widening of fiscal deficit. So let us see the conditions where the fiscal deficit can be widened. So one is, how is our revenue expenditure management? So most of the times, revenue expenditure crosses the expected limits. And this is what we call it as irresponsible spending. And second aspect is, if the capital expenditure has increased to an extent, that is good. And on the other hand, fiscal deficit may increase when the receipts are not as expected, the tax receipts. So let us see how the situation in 2017-18 is. Remember this, direct tax revenues, where these direct tax revenues comes up? The tax revenues are the part of revenue receipts. They have went up. To an extent, indirect tax revenues have decreased because of improper implementation of GST. And coming to capital receipts, it is the disinvestments. So disinvestment proceedings have crossed 1 lakh crore rupees. It is extremely good performance this year. And then the tax devolutions, they comes under revenue expenditure. The tax devolutions to the states have increased. So in a nutshell, what we can say is the revenue expenditure went out of the limits. That has made this year's fiscal deficit target to be breached by the government. What was the stated fiscal deficit target for 2017-18? It was 3.2%. Now, where we stand, it is around 3.5%. So, when the fiscal deficit is widened, what are the consequences? It leads to greater inflation. Why greater inflation? That will be covered in your economy classes. And also, it decreases the quality of expenditure. And in these circumstances, the fiscal consolidation is very much essential. And let's go to the economic survey votes, what Mr. Arvind Subramanian has said. When India is going through a growth path, we need to take every concern for the fiscal consolidation. So let us see this way. One thing is, this year's budget is not a growth-oriented budget. I am making a statement. This year's budget is not a growth-oriented budget. It means there is no emphasis on public investments or public capital expenditure. Then what is the emphasis is on? Is more and more on welfare programs. It means revenue expenditure is going to increase over the capital expenditure. So the first thing is, today inflation and inflation expectations are rising. Then monetary policy interest rates are going to increase, which we call it as tightening of monetary policy. And this tightening of monetary policy is also necessary for the reason that US Fed is raising the interest rates. There can be a flow of capital away from the country. So it means the monetary policy is no more going to give a growth stimulus. And already fiscal policy also not giving a growth stimulus. Then on what the government is depending upon for growth stimulus? It is private investments. Because previous years, demonetization, GST, twin balance sheet syndrome, these are all stated to be the reasons for low growth path. Now, demonetization is weaning off, its impact is weaning off. GST is getting streamlined. Bankruptcy insolvency code and recapitalization of the banks is expected to address the twin balance sheet syndrome. So obviously, the private investments are expected to flow and these private investments are expected to take us on a growth path. So the growth path is no more through state intervention. We are expecting it to be seen through private investments and also export flows. And the next is, there is another important development. The government has heavily focused on raising the farm income. So it means, as farm incomes increase, it leads to consumer demand. This increased consumer demand is expected to fuel the growth. So in a nutshell, the growth can be fueled through four engines. One is public investment, private investment, and then exports. The next is consumer demand. So previously the growth was pushed through public investments. Now the government is trying for private investments and consumer demand. And revival of the global economy is also expected to push the Indian exports. It is going to depend on other three engines for the growth. That's what holistically this budget is expecting or this budget is showing to us. Now, let us see certain numbers. So, what are the numbers for 2018-19? So, what is the fiscal deficit target number? So, last year in the budget, Finance Minister stated that for 2018-19, they are expecting to get a fiscal consolidation. But now, in this budget, it was pegged at 3.3%. It means we moved away from fiscal consolidation path. And second aspect here, with regard to fiscal deficit is this. By 2020-21, only by then, we are expected to get into 3% target of the fiscal deficit. Don't remember too many numbers. Just this, what is the fiscal deficit target under FRBM? When we are expected to reach to the target, that you need to remember over here. And there is another target given by FRBM committee, that is debt to GDP ratio has to reach to 40%. Debt of Indian government has to decrease. So government did not announce any steps for this too. And why the fiscal slippage is expected this year? It means more this budget is an welfare budget. Second is, overheating of the asset prices is the major problem. Especially the stock market asset prices are skyrocketing. So in this context, Once these starts down sloping, then how the disinvestment targets have to be achieved, that is another concern. Now, there is a huge positive side in for India. So the tax to GDP ratio, it was stagnating around 10% for India. Now it is raised up to 12%. By 2020-21, it is expected to raise to 12.7%. So the biggest positive for India will be direct tax beyond sea. And coming to indirect taxes, the customs duties are raised. So here we need to understand one point. We are talking about free trade under globalization. So government of India, to encourage make in India, it has raised the customs duties. So to what extent it is in tune with the globalization, we have to see over here. And third aspect is, coming back to the taxes or tax receipts, corporate tax. So the corporate people have expected many benefits, but nothing has happened. So this corporate tax is reduced to 25% for companies up to 250 crores. Previously, the limit was 50 crores. It was raised to 250 crores. Now, stock markets. Here, there is a shocker. So long-term capital gains tax was reintroduced. So without any indexing benefit. What is indexing benefit, we have to understand. Let's take, you bought a share at 10 rupees. And then inflation in the market, it is around 2 or 3 rupees. The pricing of the share is taken as 13 rupees. And then if you sell it for 16 rupees, the difference is 3 rupees is taken as a profit. So it means the bond is indexed to inflation. So now, without any indexing benefit, this tax will be collected. It means this 2 to 3 rupees will not be taken into consideration. 16 minus 10, it is 6 rupees is going to be your gain, and you have to pay the taxes on this gain. So the capital gains, long-term capital gains tax is introduced. Why? 2 days back, we saw the article. So government is differentiating between equities and debt instruments. Especially share market and loans, there is a huge differentiation. So in this context, the choices of the customers will increase if government applies its taxes equally or uniformly across these. Though government did not bring in uniformity in the case of long-term capital gains tax, it at least imposed the capital gains on the stock market instruments. Second aspect is, will it affect the ongoing growing rise in stock markets? No. Why? The alternative instruments have greater tax rates. So that's why there is no choice left to the customers other than to depend upon stock exchange. And second aspect, what are the other avenues outside India to invest? Because India is showing a promising growth to the investors now. So in these circumstances, rise in long-term capital gains tax at this juncture is not expected to harm. And then middle income groups, the salaried employees, they got one benefit, that is 40,000 rupees deduction, a standard deduction. So it means if you are earning some 5 lakh rupees, on that 40,000 rupees income will go through a standard deduction. Previously, the medical expenses and transport or travel expenses are excluded from this income, and then your net income is calculated. Now, in the place of these two, a 40,000 rupees standard deduction is being applied. That is only the benefit which they got. But however, it is offset. How it was offset? Because the 4% is the rise in education cess. Now, this rise in education cess is going to offset whatever the benefits they got under this standard deduction. Now, here we have to discuss about cess a bit more. Because education cess is raised, and second thing is the cess on the excise duties are reduced by 8 rupees on petroleum products. But it has introduced a new cess that is called infrastructure cess. So with regard to infrastructure cess, the state governments are going to have an objection. Because when it was the excise duty Under Article 270 of the Constitution, excise duties are coming under shareable pool of taxes with the states. When it has become a cess, either it is the rise in education cess or imposition of infrastructure cess on petroleum and diesel, it is going to be only with the central government. So the states will definitely have an objection with regard to the rise in cess and reduction in excise duties with regard to petroleum products are being concerned. And further to this, if you carefully observe, the disinvestment target this year is around 80,000 crore rupees. It can be safely reached if we consider the ongoing bull run in the stock markets. So in this context, let's take another point for discussion. Okay, disinvestments are going forward. What are the companies to be disinvested? NHPL. And with regard to general insurance, there is a huge reform exercise the government intends to undertake. So what is this reform exercise there? Three general insurance companies will be brought under one company and it will be put for sale. And you know Air India's strategic sale is already on cards. So if we go by the existing market, reaching this 80,000 target is not going to be a great difficulty. On the expenditure side, I want to talk to you about only one program which is related to health. So Ayushman Bhava, this is what is the program. So in this, if you pay 330 rupees as a premium, 5 lakh rupees will be ensured to the family for expenditure. So insurance based mechanism is created. So it means that India is more moving towards what do we call it as American model of healthcare delivery rather than UK Canadian model of community-centric delivery or state-centered healthcare delivery mechanism. So this American-centric healthcare model is insurance-centered and the state will provide for the necessary insurance and private sector is going to dominate the healthcare delivery. So how it is going to influence our healthcare sector, we need to observe and see that. And senior citizens has got certain benefits and it is not going to be much important from our exam perspective. So this is in a nutshell about the budget. The big bang reform, that is minimum support prices. So two important points. It was extended to all crops. So it means previously the distortion in cropping pattern is majorly due to MSP being awarded only to certain crops. Now, MSP is linked to the production cost as suggested by M.S. Swaminathan. So it means it will be 50% above the production cost. So it means income security is going to come to the farmer. So as we give the income security to the farmer, the other side that is going to get damaged is the consumer. So it means the inflation is going to increase in the economy as the food prices are bound to take an upward turn. And second aspect is, on the other side, in perspective of the growth, as farmers' incomes increases, these are expected to provide for a growth stimulus. So these are the things we need to understand over here. But the modalities, Niti Aayog has to decide. It means only for the next Kharif crop, we can expect this MSPs to be implemented. So let's wait and see how the modalities are going to be, then only we can make a concrete comment. So, should India have simultaneous elections? I have discussed this article many a times for you. So, what are the simultaneous elections? Positive points. So, people argue that governance has to be continuous. And any government which has got the mandate of the people, it shall be given 5 years' time to prove itself. And modal code of conduct, it is obstructing the welfare programs and affecting the poor. And cost is going to be decreased because of this simultaneous elections. Logistically, it is easy for the election commission. That's what is one of the argument. But I don't agree with this argument. Logistically, simultaneous elections is going to be a nightmare. On the other side, the fixed tenure or constructive motion of no confidence, these have to be introduced to make the simultaneous elections possible. If a government loses its confidence on the floor of the house, still it will be continuing in the government only for the reason that it has no alternative. So this is not going to be in the democratic interest. And democracies are expected to be chaotic with delays and these changes. So we need to accept that. And it is also not in the federal interest, because the local governments or regional parties are going to face only one election. So the multiple elections as a problem is more for national parties. And as the national parties are very centralized, even regional parties too, so they have to bring their star campaigners. So obviously the major headache with the different election schedules is not for the regional parties, but for the national parties. So that's why they are pitching for it. And third aspect, now, when simultaneous elections were held, a voter may get confused and may vote for the same party at the union and the state level. In those circumstances, if a party gets a majority both at the union and majority of the states, then it may push for the majoritarian tendencies. So if one party gets majority, absolute majority at union and most of the states, the constitutional amendment and changing everything in the constitution becomes a cakewalk. And then, how to bring in a modality with regard to simultaneous conduct of elections is not at clear. And misuse of Article 356, if it exists in the country, simultaneous elections will not be of much use. So from these perspectives, we need to talk about budget discussions, which is expected to grow. So whatever is given in from this page onwards to the last page, that is to the 15th page, I have discussed them in a nutshell to you. Don't worry about the numbers, which what got what. Worry about the perspective on the budget. That's what I tried to give you in this particular discussion. Thank you very much and all the best.